joining us this evening on Conversations on Practice, part of our public talk series here at Jameel Arts Centre. We're lucky to be doing this one in collaboration with Maraya Arts Centre. We've been so gracious to bring curator Laura Metzler here with Palestinian Saudi artist Dana Awartani, whose show is currently on at Maraya Arts Centre until February 18th. We have series of talks all throughout the year, so please keep checking our What's On section to learn more about our programs. We have a talk on Sunday evening as well with GPP Photo Week. And with that, I hand over to Laura and Dana to get started about the conversation on practice. Thank you.
All right. Oh, already on. Perfect. Thank you so much, Lana, and thank you, Art Jameel, and everybody for coming. It's our second collaboration with the Sharjah Islamic Arts Festival and has been supported by AXA Arts. There's actually a tour with Dana. If anybody hasn't seen the exhibition, as Dana said, the show's on until February 18th. But the tour is on Friday at 3 p.m. at Maraya Arts Centre. We'd love for you to be there. So this is Dana's first institutional show within the Middle East. It's been really fun putting it together and exciting. I think hopefully this is going to be a fairly like casual discussion. Yeah. We've been working on it for roughly a year, so a lot of it's just kind of there. What we do with these talks is kind of go through the artist's practice. We try to do one for each exhibition. This is the first one at Art Jameel. And so we kind of talk about the elements in the practice, how you know the work has developed, kind of where we leading up to the show, but to get like the full show experience, you have to come see it. Mm-hmm. So with that, I mean, kind of the structure roughly is looking at geometry as kind of the base of her practice, and we're going to kind of talk about education and the learning the fundamentals, and then also her experimentation with material and the importance of materiality and craft and the different methods that go along with it. And then start getting into the more recent works that then take this interest in geometry and material into these experiential, kind of socially driven or informed works. So with that, Donna's going to do like 98% of the talking. I'm basically going to like push every once in a while, push and pull. We have a lot of visuals, but don't worry, we'll all get through. And we'll do a Q&A at the end. So I will let you go ahead and start.
Okay. Thank you, Laura. And thank you for everyone who came, and to Art Jameel. I'm really excited to be here. So I think a good way to start off this talk is by talking a bit about my background and my education, because that's really informed my practice. And I first started studying at Central St. Martin's in London, and I loved being there. I thought it was such a great experience, and you're surrounded by some of the best like young artists, but I had a huge problem there with the fact that they really kind of push you how to think conceptually and develop works and research, but the idea of making was not important. So there was no sort of guidance or significance or emphasis on how to make or how to use your hands or anything that I feel is crucial to art. And also I was kind of really stereotyped there as the only Arab artist. You know, a lot of the kind of references they told me to look at were, you know, Shirin Nishat and Muna Hatoum was the only sort of kind of idea of the Middle East that they had. And I'm not saying, you know, those, they talk about suppression and exile, which are very relevant, unfortunately, now more than ever. But for me, it was something I didn't really relate to. You know, I'm not a refugee or an exile. I'm Palestinian, but, you know, I'm a third generation Palestinian. I'm not suppressed. You know, my family are fairly liberal. So I couldn't really relate to that. So I was trying to find different sort of ideas and nuances of what it means to sort of be an Arab besides those two narratives. And that led me to the Princeton School of Traditional Arts after. And it was a completely different form of studying and learning. Like, I remember the first day I got there, they said to me, we don't care that you're a contemporary artist. You're going to come to the school as a craftswoman. So you're going to leave your ego at the door, and you're just going to immerse yourself in how to make. And it was an amazing program because it was a 2 years intensive master's where they teach you all about different crafts. So from woodwork to gilding to natural pigments to geometry, so all of that. And they made like a really beautiful comparison when you look at they say contemporary art is made by man for man's ego, whereas traditional art is made by man for God, you know? And I thought that was something really interesting. And what I really try to do in my practice is find the middle ground, because there's such a huge divide between the contemporary art world and the crafts are generally shunned. And unfortunately, in our region, they're completely dying out. And I really believe in reviving them and finding ways of contemporizing them. So like this image on the screen is one of my first earlier works that I did when I first left the Prince's School. And I was in a space where I was still trying to find what I wanted to say. And I was more of a mediator who just kind of tried to talk about this knowledge and this language of sacred geometry that's been forgotten and just try to translate it into my audience. So these few paintings that you're going to see are based on progressional drawings. And here, I was studying the basics of geometry, because all of the designs, everything you do begins and finishes within a circle. And I love this idea of kind of unity within multiplicity, or like another expression they can relate to in a spiritual sense is tawhid. So this idea of oneness and how everything is connected, and going back to nature and seeing the underlying language of nature, and also just to kind of have my audience and viewers experience geometry with me, because most people, when they see it, they're just like, yeah, it's, you know, something highly decorative, it's beautiful, you decorate floors, houses, and doors with it. But actually, you know, there's much, much more to it. So it was a journey of learning as well as making these drawings that I did at the beginning. And then these are one of the drawings as well that's on in show Maraya.
Then I think the next thing that we want, so then this is an earlier one when you started kind of moving beyond into, I'm just going to scroll through them. You started moving into like showing the process in a more like complicated way. Mm-hmm. The earlier ones so have kind of three panels, and this is the first six and was also kind of your entry into illumination.
Yeah, so this is my first illumination work, which is, it's called The 6 Days of Creation. So still my work was really based on the spiritual and the religious and the significance of what it means and trying to understand that. And what this work kind of is, it's quite important because it led me to go to Turkey and start studying to become a master in illumination. And I was really drawn to the sort of form of pedagogy there, because it's not like a university or course you enroll in. It's a very traditional way of learning that's been around for centuries. It's like, you know, you approach the master and you ask her, you know, if you will be the apprentice, really, and then they teach you. And they teach you for as long or as little they think is appropriate. You know, sometimes it can take 2 years, sometimes it can take 20, 30 years until you become a master in your own right. And she can't just grant you that permission. So collectively, all the other masters have to sign off and agree. And I've been doing that, and hopefully I'm going to get it next year. So that would be amazing, because I also believe in order to change and evolve traditional arts, you really need to understand its principles. You know, it's an art form, like I said, that's been around for centuries. And, you know, I think as an artist, you have to humble yourself to really understand that, because it's a very complex. And the thing I really loved about that is, you know, when I was with her in Turkey, it was all about how to do it. So she taught me everything from the designs and how to paint and how to draw and how to compose. But also there was no why, you know, the meaning behind it was gone. Like, these are examples of very, very traditional compositions and different styles of illumination. And then, you know, after I leave Turkey, I was kind of reflecting on all of my training with her. And it led me to produce one of my first kind of contemporary illuminations, which is also on show at Maraya, and it's coming up.
I think it's this here. One. Yeah, here we go.
So with this work, like I was saying before, the history and the symbolism of it is all dead. And so I kind of did my own research to understand what is illumination, how it started, and all of that. And what I realized about it that was so beautiful is it doesn't belong to one culture or one specific civilization. It's an art form that started really in the 7th century all the way up to the Ottoman Empire. And each kind of different civilization has contributed, like the Safavids, the Mughals, the Abbasids. And I love the idea of a collective identity through illumination. And this is a sort of historical timeline where it starts from the top left of the origins of illumination being just a gold dot. And then the next one, there's the red, which was the first introduction of color. And then, you know, it progresses all the way to the end where it shows how it evolved and become more complex.
This one has a little, like, the kind of starting panel and the ending panel.
Yeah, you know, and once again, like, I like the idea of a shared sort of art form with a shared culture. So it was all the way from, like, Andalusia to the Far East. They all have practiced it and all contributed in the same way.
So then I think this brings us back to sort of the beginning. And this is a piece that you did at Central St. Martin's called Orientalism that it's also on view at ISRA, I think, right now.
Yeah, it was on ISRA. So, yeah, this work was the first work I did for my degree show at St. Martin's. And it was kind of the first time I did installation piece. And I was combining the traditional with the contemporary. So these patterns are actually inspired by traditional paintings you see on Saudi houses. And, you know, people's perception of Saudi when you see Saudi is like, you know, it's just very gray, black and white, when actually it had such a rich architectural, cultural history. And I call this piece Orientalism, you know, kind of based on Edward Said's text where, you know, you have this idea of people fetishizing the East. And it was made out of just installation tape. So the work isn't permanent. And it kind of, once it finishes, it just, you rip it apart and throw it away. You know, it has no sort of home because the tape doesn't last. And this kind of shows the geometry behind it. So I did like the proper technical geometric drawings and covered all of that up. So it does also talk about the destruction of culture and heritage, which is happening, you know, all throughout the Middle East. And then,
I mean, like, that was the first kind of non-paper work. And then after the Prince of School, this was 2016. So this is an installation view from the sixth Marrakesh Biennial. These are the Platonic solids, yeah, which also then again show up at Maraya. Maybe go ahead and talk about these.
So this work is really important as well for my practice because it was the first time I've ever collaborated with someone else. And the people I collaborated with were craftsmen in Morocco. And it was a really amazing experience because the thing is, I found that's also very sad is craftsmen at one point throughout history used to be some of the most important people in society. And now they're like the poorest people and the knowledge is completely dying out. There's no appreciation for what they do anymore. So I kind of, wanted to work with them to revive this craft work, which is inlay. And here I was looking at the Platonic solids, which are they were created by Plato, and they're known as the five only perfect shapes that... let me start some water. Yeah. So they're seen as the five only perfect shapes that fit within a sphere harmoniously. And they're the fundamentals of all geometry, all architecture. And here I was looking at the principle of the jewels. So each one has a partner that fits within one another. So it's purely a formal mathematical study of it.
And the thing that makes them perfect, I think, is every side is exactly the same size and every angle is exactly the same.
Yeah.
Just geometrically.
And it was also really moving for me because the craftsmen themselves really enjoyed the process, brought their families over to the opening, and this sense of pride that historically they used to have has kind of come back. So it really made me think about how to produce artwork, you know, because I do feel one of the biggest problems in the art world is the artist is very detached from the process of making. You know, it's just sometimes really as simple as coming up with just an idea, then outsourcing it to a factory to make it. And I'm someone who finds the process of making more important than the end result. So it was really just thinking about a sustainable way to make work, ethical way as well. And this was made with an artist who has his own atelier where he's based in Morocco. And he's gathered around 12 craftsmen that work for him full time. And I was really inspired by that. But then it kind of led me to find my own ways of production. So the new ones that I made for this show were made with craftsmen I met in India. And yeah, here's some sketches. This is the master craftsman in Morocco.
And then, yeah, for Maraya, in Marrakesh, they had shown three. For Maraya, we went ahead and finished the set, so it's all five.
All five, yeah.
And a different scale. So there's also, like, a whole scale change.
Yeah.
And a detail of kind of the final. So then I guess when we talk about for this piece, this is the first one that you actually worked with craftsmen in India.
Yeah.
For is for the Kochi Biennial, the last one, also 2017.
16
as well?
Yeah. So yeah, this was also my first time. This was before the wood pieces. I created this also in India with textile embroiderers. And it was really amazing because when I got there, they wanted me to kind of do something that, you know, was related to India and to do with crafts. And literally I was spoiled for choice. I could have done anything, but I was really drawn to textiles. And this work was created with embroiderers in Ahmedabad. And the story behind this piece is actually inspired by a Sufi poet called Ibn Arabi. And I read this really beautiful article that there was a story of when he went one day to Mecca, and he was in a transcendent state, and he heard the Kaaba tell him, "Come and do tawaf around me, and come and drink my Zamzam water." So every time he did a tawaf around the Kaaba, he wrote a love letter in dedication to the Kaaba, and these eight poems are considered to be some of the most beautiful forms of Arabic literature on the theme of love that have ever been written. So I just kind of reinterpret that sort of idea by having these eight panels that have these geometric embroidery, which are supposed to kind of reference this poetry. And there, it's suspended as a perfect cube, you know, and I want the viewers to kind of walk around the space to see the work. And that's images of it being made.
And I think the next one, yeah, these are some older works that were kind of thinking about this craft process, but you made them in Saudi and were having kind of issues with finding the craftspeople to work with them. Maybe go ahead and talk a little bit about these.
Yeah, so this work it's called The Five Stages of Grief. And I've been working from a really young age with my mom, who's part of this charity called Mansujat, and it's all about preserving and reviving Saudi textiles. We actually set up some of the stuff here in the gift shop. And, you know, a big kind of thing that's forgotten about Saudi is before the unification of Saudi, every single tribe in every single region had a distinct sort of dress. And you could tell where someone was from, their status in society, just from what they're wearing. Now, after they unified the country, they abolished all of that. And they're like, men wear white, women wear black. So these pieces, the top halves, are actually authentic top half of thobes that were found from a tribe in Thagif. And the bottom half were actually inspired by traditional talismans, which are seen of, like, the people usually wear them to protect themselves. And I kind of made one in relation to the different five stages of grief. But, you know, going back to the idea about the craft, there is no craftsman in Saudi at all. You know, they don't exist. So I was in a where I could only do it with machine. And then that's when it led me on to go to India and start working by hand and going to kind of revive that, because in Saudi, it's sadly all dead and they don't really have that history anymore. And then, yeah.
So yeah, let's give a little bit more details on it, so you can get an idea of the geometry. Kind of each panel is using a different, like, level of the sacred geometry,
yeah,
from like the eightfold into the one. And it's all activated by the window, so you have the light moving through it, which is quite beautiful. Okay, and then we have this piece. So this was part of 2139?
Yeah.
2 years ago.
Yes. So this work also is really, really important because it's the first time I worked with like technology and video and all of that. And I am so petrified of working with technology. You know, I'm someone who's like really primitive, who likes to paint and do a craft. So I thought I would try to push myself. And it was also the first time where I was no longer talking about the geometry. And I used the geometry as a medium to talk about something else because I felt I got to a point where I understood it enough to push it even further. So this work is actually entitled I Went Away and Forgot You. It's a much longer title, but it's from a poem of Mahmoud Darwish. And if you go to the next slide.
I think, yeah, we have a clip of it.
Yeah, you can watch this. Like, this is a shorter version. It's actually a 22-minute long film, but you can see this.
And then we'll talk a little bit more about, like, the context of where it is.
So this was made out of sand, if you guys didn't realize in the video, and it was talking about the kind of architectural, like, kind of destruction that's going on in Saudi Arabia. And if you look at the image on the left, those are traditional Hijazi homes that you have in Balad, and the architecture made sense to the space. And, you know, everyone before in the 50s used to live in these houses. But what happened is this was during the time when Egypt was being colonized, and there was this Italian kind of French influence that was trickling into Egypt. And this idea of adopting Western kind of Western traditions made you more civilized. So what people started doing, the very richer, more privileged family, is started leaving these traditional homes and building homes with this European aesthetic in Saudi. And the image on the right is the first ever home that was built in this Italian style, and that's where the installation was done. And so what I did is I wanted to kind of create something that was so obviously visually Arab that you'd see in a lot of Arab homes, create it with sand and then destroy it. To just and talk about how we are purposely destroying our culture. You know, whether if you look at countries like Syria, Iraq, it's through war, or I feel in the Gulf, we are doing it by kind of modernizing in such a rapid pace where it's becoming reckless and you're no longer preserving or taking care of the history. And I didn't want to create the work in a way that was aggressive or would, you know, shock people. So that's why I decided to sweep it in a very kind of purposeful, therapeutic way. And it's funny because the reaction I got from a lot of people was like, oh my God, you know, please put plexiglass on top of the sand. You should protect it. You know, we can whatever, whatever. And they're just kind of giving me tips on how to preserve it. And I was just like, you know, well, that's exactly what you're doing to your own culture in a way, is purposely destroying it. And, you know, the title of the work also references that because it's, you know, I went away and forgot you. You were like a dream. You know, it talks about this time when people used to live in these traditional homes that are so far gone that they're, you know, a lot of people don't even remember it anymore. So it's more of a cautionary tale. So just to tell people, you know, this is what we're doing. And thankfully, things are slowly changing. Yeah.
We can talk a little bit about the processes, because, I mean, even with all of the paintings, you use these, use the kind of historic processes of creating the colors. So, I mean, and you did that with the sand as well. So the video is sort of creating all of the colors with these different pigments.
Yeah. So also, like Laura said, the materials are super important. So I only paint with, like, natural pigments and 24 karat gold, and I like to kind of keep it as pure and original as possible. So even with the sand, I didn't want to buy synthetically dyed sand, so I gathered sand from Saudi and bought these natural pigments and then just grinded buckets and buckets of them at a time. And it was super toxic, like it says, you know, be careful. And I was just like blowing rainbow snot for like weeks on end. And then, but my hands are super smooth, which is great.
And running your hands through toxic materials.
Yeah, it was very, like it says, very harmful. But yeah, and it was very laborious. I mean, just the dyeing, you know, takes a couple of days to do. And then the next video shows the time-lapse of how it's each tile is actually made.
And this has been shown at a number of places now. So I saw it at 2139. It was also at the Mosaic Rooms. Where else have you?
Jakarta Biennale.
Yeah, the Jakarta Biennale.
Frank Nuero.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's been kind of traveling, but lots of labor and that travel.
Yeah, it's very painful to remake every time. And then that's it when it's finished. So yeah, with this work, it really... If it was the first time I kind of felt like there was something I wanted to say that was important, you know, about our culture and society, and it was no longer talking about geometry and symbolism of it and what it means, but now using it as a medium of expression. And that then led on to the next work.
I think, yeah, this is...
Yeah, so this is called Listen to My Words. And it's also in collaboration with embroidery craftsmen. So it's hand embroidery on hand-woven silk. And this piece came about when I came across an amazing book, which you also have here, surprisingly. it's a book called Poetry by Arab Women. And I always thought that, you know, historically in the Arab world, or this Muslim world, you always think of Hafiz, Ibn Arabi, Rumi, you know, Khalil Gibran, and all these big names who are men. And I just thought there was no tradition really of female poets until I came across this book. And I was shocked because it dates back to like the Jahiliya kind of 6th, 7th century all the way to the 12th century. And women all across, from also from Spain all the way to Iran, and they were super radical. I mean, they're talking about, you know, being empowered, being independent, about lust, about longing, about sex. And I was shocked. I'm like, you know, and these, some of them were daughters and wives and nieces of caliphs, who were the religious rulers. And I just thought, you know, what happened? You know, how come we, you know, if you said any of these poems out loud today in Saudi or here, you'd probably be imprisoned. So I kind of wanted to bring attention to that. So this also was inspired by another story that I heard by about this woman called Noor Jahan. And she was an empress in India, and her husband was the king, but supposedly he was not a very good ruler. He was quite incompetent. So she used to rule for him, but she was never allowed to sit in the courts with the men because she's a woman. So she used to have to sit behind a mishrabiya, or a jali, what it's called, which is like a lattice screen. So she would whisper in his ear how to govern the whole empire. And, you know, this kind of narrative that you hear about always women being hidden and leading from behind is quite present, I found, in a lot of cultures and different histories. So I wanted to recreate the idea of this mishrabiya, but with embroidery. So they are supposed to reference these sort of screens. And above each one, there's a speaker. And I re-recorded the poems with Saudi women that I feel like are really pushing the boundaries and really kind of embody these sort of poetesses. We re-recorded them and created a sort of feeling where it's a bit of a majlis, you know, those traditional salons that, you know, throughout history, you'd sit and converse and recite poetry. So I wanted to create something like that, you know. So, and the space itself, it's an immersive space, and I wanted something very relaxing and therapeutic that invites you in, but also juxtaposed by being interjected by these kind of really powerful words. You know, a lot of the men in Saudi, when they heard this installation, they were really shocked. You know, they're like, oh my God, you know, what is this? How can you say this? But then I had women who cried, you know, so I found it really interesting, how the two opposite ends of the spectrum, how they related to it.
And I mean, I think that's something that's interesting about it, because it's essentially made this impossible salon where these women across time who didn't necessarily have access to each other's poetry can actually respond to one another and to kind of create this dialogue. And it's also then kind of looking at the screens, not necessarily, I mean, this and some of the other works that's developed, I think, is sort of also kind of making the debate about the kind of, whether it's empowering or limiting, kind of irrelevant about the screen. It's because it's trying to kind of look at more at who these women are. And that book is also kind of interesting because there's, I think there's only, I could only find like two anthologies, I think, that were focused on Arab female poetry. One very intense one in Arabic that has, I think, like 400 poems. And then this one. But even while they're trying to like track the history of who a lot of these women are, it's kind of, it's most of them are kind of like, it's a name and we don't know anything else, or we don't know who this woman is either.
Unknown.
Yeah, there's a lot of, which kind of plays into other works in the show.
Yeah.
We'll kind of run through some of the details. Yeah, so this is kind of the back end. Each screen has the three layers that then when you look at it, it kind of collapses and shows you the full pattern.
Yeah. And also another really interesting detail is the stitch work that I chose for this work that is a form of embroidery that was invented during Noor Jahan's time. So, you know, it's also a kind of referencing the craft that she loved. And she was a poet herself and loved embroidery. And this is the guy I work with. I love him. He's the master embroiderer. His name is Sharif Bey. And this is him just working on some of the screens.
Together. and then this work was totally commissioned for this show. And I thought it was kind of fun to talk about like the process of developing it. Because we didn't really know what the final result was actually going to look like until it was up. It's like 205 glass pieces.
Yeah. So.
We kind of want to talk about like the foundations for it.
Yep. So this was 200 and something hand-blown glass pieces, also made in India. Can you go to the next image?
Yeah.
So okay, here we go. If you look at the image on the right, this is a little sketch I did beforehand, which is basically just looking at the hexagon and the triangle. And these two shapes are the principles of all of the screens I made. So all of the different patterns were based on these two designs. And you can technically create infinite amount of designs just from these two things. So, you know, I was reading in a book where they talk about like the principles of Islamic architecture, and the chapter about these mashrabiyas or screens, they said that they were something amazing because they allowed women to see but not be seen. And I found that really problematic because in essence, it makes women invisible. So, you know, she just sits behind and just looks. So I wanted to kind of examine this idea of the interior space being female and the masculine space being outside. So these shapes in essence are the where the light shines through a mashrabiyah. So where the lattice is, the light goes through and then creates these shapes. And so I reproduced them in glass, these two basic shapes at different lengths, and kind of was looking at, you know, the different lengths of when light reflects through, and then created this installation out of it. So you can, the next picture. Oh, this is mock-ups I was trying to do because I wasn't sure exactly how I wanted to make it. So I made like around 100 paper models to scale and played around with them.
We did a lot of WhatsApp curating. yeah, and this is one of the details of the piece. And yeah, this one you can see some of the patterns. It's one of the only kind of, I think it's the only moment in the show, at least, where the geometry is like pretty much unrecognizable.
Yeah.
Even when you get like right underneath it, you can kind of find it, but it's really skewing with that perfection. And then, yeah. There's a tour on Friday at 3 p.m. This was kind of the start of it. We wanted to open it up also to questions and see if there's any kind of elements that people wanted to go into a bit more.
Hi, I just wanted to ask you, you referenced a lot of the kind of educational programs that you've been a part of, and thinking, and the sense that I got was you were kind of looking for educational methodologies that would then inform your practice and the relationship with that and the process of then how you work with other people to kind of like speaking with the people you collaborate with about contemporary art and the relationship between education, and if there's any kind of thinking going forward that really thinks about like pedagogical theory.
Mm-hmm.
In your work, does that make any sense?
Kind of. So you're saying how do you, I imagine, education?
Or no, I just thought like the relationship between you and the kind of educational institutions that you've been a part of, and the education process kind of informing the making process,
mm-hmm.
but like systematically the way
thing, like the way you are taught in XYZ school kind of really informing the ways that you make, and even kind of like the way you relate your work to people, the collaborators that you work with and people who make that work for you, and the kind of like explanation or like teaching process that you then have to do when you kind of work with other collaborators.
So, I mean, the thing is, like, throughout history, in terms of the ways of learning art, it's really fluctuated. I mean, before, you know, traditionally it was all about sitting at a board and easel and painting. Yeah, that was seen as a craft. But the word craft itself has such a taboo around it in the contemporary art world that aesthetic sometimes is bad. So, you know, I don't see these sort of large institutions ever changing, because the reality is as well about learning these crafts is, even when I studied at the Prince's School, they were 1 week programs, which is not sufficient to learn anything properly. You know, so you kind of have to take it upon yourself to learn more and more. But I think just like the simple step of, you know, showing how craft can have a place in contemporary art and be relevant and evolve, because also craft is stuck in time. And going back to using your hands is okay, because, you know, you need to think of the art ecosystem. It's very capitalistic and based on mass producing and, you know, producing 100 editions just to sell and everything. And I'm really opposed to that. You know, everything is already really fast paced, and I like to go back to just sitting and taking a month, 3 months, 4 months, 6 months to produce one work, which is not really sustainable as well for other people. But in terms of like with the craftsmen as well, you know, a lot of the craftsmen that I've come across are not in a position to, you know, financially just open up their own spaces and do contemporary works or anything. You know, they need the sort of artist or designer to collaborate with. And this actually, what I saw is that's really interesting in India is it's really, really, really happening, but more in fashion than in arts. I mean, most of the young designers only work with hand-woven, hand-dyed textiles that they produce directly with craftsmen. And it's a big deal. And I love that, you know. Like, after this, I'm just like, why am I shopping at Zara anymore? You know, when you're creating something sustainable, you're giving back to them. And also, it's, you know, an art form in itself. So, but I'm also seeing more artists that are doing this. Also, more like in India, more artists that are working directly with craftsmen. You know, there's only one space I came across where it's a bunch of craftsmen who set up a sort of production house that do everything from woodwork to casting to welding and everything like that. Did I answer your question? Yeah.
What is the name of the book, the poetry book?
Poetry by Arab Women.
It's a classical poem.
It's the only poem, poetry Arab book in there.
Yeah. Where can you buy it?
The Jameel bookstore. Conveniently.
Conveniently, yeah. Yeah.
Also, if somebody didn't get the catalog, you can also take a catalog, and some of the poems that are in the Listen to My Words installation are in the catalog. Yes, the shop is open. And they would love for you to get it, I'm sure.
Hi, Hi, I'm incredibly interested in what you were talking about in terms of shared cultures throughout history using the same sort of crafts and developing them in their own different ways. How do you think other cultures, because you talk a lot about Turkey and India maintaining some degree of their crafts, but like Saudi, the example you gave where it's almost dead. Mm-hmm. How do you think other cultures who once used these same crafts have responded to that same like rapid urbanization that everyone else has gone through? And who do you think is the best example of maintaining at least some degree of importance in the crafts?
First of all, by far India is the best, because the craftsmen are still alive and practicing through all corner spectrums, and you know they're required, they're an important part of society, especially like I said, textiles. Well, Saudi doesn't really have much craft in comparison, because, you know, besides Hejaz, the rest of it was just a desert. You know, there wasn't much. It's similar with a lot of the Gulf countries. The sort of craft is very basic in comparison to, like, you know, Syria, Iraq, and all of those who have had thousands and thousands of years of history. Now, like, in terms, I think Turkey as well is doing well, because they have a very, very, very strong community when it comes to illuminators and calligraphers, and that tradition is still alive, and they have a thriving art scene of their own. But also it's very segregated and not part of contemporary arts. And I think like the best way really is by kind of bringing them back into, you know, using them for architecture, using them for product design, using them for fashion again, you know. And I think there is an interest in reviving that. And people also with Syrian craftsmen are doing that because they're all displaced. And that's really, you know, in Syria before they had something like 25 wood workshops in the old Medina. Now there's only two standing, you know. So I think there's a lot of people and NGOs that are trying to revive them and take care of them. And yeah.
Hi, my name is Henry. I am with an art center in Cairo, Egypt. Oh, okay. And our art center is actually very close to Jameel, Cairo. So if anyone ever come to Cairo, please come visit me. I'm the curator there.
what's the name?
Oh, sorry. Darb.
Amazing.
Darb, D-A-R-B. It's in O Cairo. So we also have a couple contemporary show coming up as well. But it's not my day today. my question was, a lot of... superstar artists have teams of artists working with them, yeah, and crafters working with them. So people are doing it anyway. But at the same time, you see that there's some dialogue between what's being craft, what's being contemporary art, and maybe as curator, as art practitioner, can you elaborate on that sort of struggle or that sort of thin line?
What is between craft and contemporary art?
Sometimes people define contemporary art a little bit more with the message behind,
yes,
it, whatnot. I mean, some can be very pretentious, some not. But so there's a struggle between how do you mix the two together. You do it really well, but if you can elaborate on that, would be awesome. Thank you.
Well, I always used to believe that. Well, the big difference, if you look at craft historically, is they kind of crafters produced to be functional objects. So, you know, something like woodwork would either be used on doors, on tables and stuff. It was never really just put on the wall for the sake of being admired. You know, it was always a functional art form. And probably at that time, it was seen as the contemporary arts because there was no other art around besides that. You know, there is a lot of, it's difficult working with craft because it is very rigid. And there is, a step kind of A, B, C, D, what you're supposed to do. And I think really to go beyond that is you need to understand it really, really, really well, understand the medium. You know, like the artist I work with, the one I collaborate with in Morocco, he's a contemporary artist, Eric, and he has his 12 craftsmen. Now, the craftsmen are masters on their own, and he has his different skill sets that he brings together. And what they do is he says all his works are collaborative works. So, you know, they put in their own creative input as well. It's not just him as a contemporary artist dictating what to do. So it's about giving them the space and, to also learn, you know, how to kind of evolve the aesthetic. Yeah.
And, I mean, curatorially, I've sort of accidentally ended up working with a number of artists who kind of blend these things. Along with Donna, I've worked with Munir Farman-Farmayan and Hive Kashraman. And with Hive in particular, it was interesting. I was also part of the Asia-Pacific Triennial. And I went and, 2 years ago now, for kind of a week with a couple of other interlocutors. And somebody had been doing research on the Marshall Islands and specifically palm weaving, which is really active and alive as an art form, but also specifically as a form of resistance. And Hive was thinking of palm weaving in terms of personal memory, as an Iraqi refugee from the Gulf War. A palm fan was one of the only things like her mom had brought with them. And so she kind of remembered this woven palm fan as this kind of symbol of Iraq while they were in Sweden and then eventually in the US, and they kind of almost kept it on an altar. But unfortunately, a lot of the intricacies and the histories of the palm weaving have been lost. And so it was kind of insane to be on the other side of the planet and having these very intense conversations about the way that the stories are being woven in and what the meaning of a similar art with a different kind of expression was. And so like curatorially, I kind of think of how that mode is being thought of and used. Hive uses it specifically in painting. And then Donna's working with all of these different kind of techniques, but then trying to turn it into something that's different from, again, like how you were talking about the function. Mm-hmm.
And so, like, what then the craft is doing and how that relationship is, I guess, curatorially really important.
I'll ask the final question. I'm intrigued by how you weave together poetry, literature, and visual arts. Mm-hmm. I was wondering how your process is when you're doing that research. Is it that the poetry sparks the sort of idea of what it will look like? Or do you come across an idea and then as you're reading, you say, oh, the narrative could work together really well between the two?
Okay, so I usually have two different ways. Either I have the idea, but I'm not sure how I want it to look, or I know what I want to create, but I don't know what I want to say. So it's always a struggle. And like, for example, you know, with the last one, Listen to My Words, with the things, it kind of, I heard, you know, the story of Noor Jahan, and I was reading this book at the same time, and I was like, oh, you know, and then that linked into the idea of the Jali and the Mashrabiya, and then, you know, I didn't want to just replicate and do marble or wood, so then that led into the embroidery. And it's the same thing with the Love is My Love is My Faith, which is the 8 panels. I started off with reading about these poems and then figuring out the form of how to do it.
But that's actually really interesting, because then the same kind of patterns turned into the glass piece. And when we did kind of the first studio visit, you still had that marble kind of in, like, playing around as an idea, which still actually hasn't made it into one of the works.
Yeah.
So there's still this, like, material kind of connection to, like, this desire to work with these, whether they come out in this project or the next project or another one.
Yeah, because the medium is really, really, really important, you know, for why I do it. It's always, it has to have some sort of significance or importance of why I'm doing it. Like, you know, for example, the Platonic solid sculptures, there are 5 of them, like I said, and Plato attributed the 5 to all the classical elements, which is earth, fire, water, air, and heaven. And now wood is the only substance that needs all of these elements to survive, you know, so that's what led me to work with wood.
All right, and I guess that's it. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Please remember that there'll be a tour Friday at Maraya Arts Centre, and if you're interested in checking out the shop, we close at 8 o'clock. Thank you.